Okay, thanks for joining us this morning. We're gonna go completely dark, except for the little cam lights here in a minute. But just wanted to introduce Dr. Vanekies. This is our Center for Bioengineering Innovation lecture series. And Jonathan joins us from the University of Arizona. And he and I have been collaborating on a number of projects for a few years, not this particular one. And so he is going to be talking about a project that I actually know very little about, so I'm actually very interested to hear it for the first time along with all of you. He is the principal investigator in the soft tissue biomechanics lab at the U of A. And the goal of this soft tissue biomechanics lab is to better understand the structure and the function of soft tissues, and then to use that information to help better understand and diagnose different types of disease states. So the work that we've done together is really in vascular grafts and blood vessel biology. And today he's going to be focusing on the eye. His background, he trained at the University of Iowa as an undergrad in biomedical engineering. He moved on to the University of Pittsburgh and completed his doctorate there. And from Pitt, he went to directly to the University of Arizona and moved up through the ranks. He's now an associate professor within the Department of Aerospace Mechanical Engineering. And he has a joint appointment as an associate professor in the Department of Biomedical Engineering. He has a resume that I ran out of paper when I printed, so I'm not going to necessarily go through all of the different accolades, but I wanted to highlight a couple of recent accomplishments that are noteworthy. So Dr. Vanekies was, in fact, the Y.C. Fung Young Investigator Award recipient, and most recently he was selected as the Western States Affiliate Research Committee for the American Heart Association. So today's talk is going to be on primary open angle glaucoma. Is intraocular pressure all that matters? So join me in welcoming Dr. Vanekies.
Maybe put it a little bit closer up.
No, it really has to be close.
Yeah.
I'll just project as best I can. So, thanks very much. I'd like to especially thank Dr. Keller for the invitation to come down. Had a beautiful drive down. Actually got to drive through Sedona yesterday. That sunset is beautiful. It's my pleasure to be here, and it's my pleasure to talk about a topic that, as Dr. Keller mentioned, he knows very little about, but actually constitutes a major research effort in my laboratory. So we're going to be talking today about the eye. I think it's only appropriate, and again, it's dark in here. I'll try not to put you to sleep. It's only appropriate we talk about major structures, at least a few that are going to be pertinent. So we all know the function of the eye is for vision, and light, of course, passes through the cornea, is focused by the lens, and is focused onto the back part of the eye, the retina. The whole eye is protected by what's called the corneal scleral shell. And it's called that because it basically is encompassed by the cornea, which transitions seamlessly into the sclera, which is this part out here, which is the white part of your eye. And in the back of the eye, the retina and the choroid, of course, are the transducers of the signal that goes to your brain. So there is an anterior chamber and a posterior chamber. So the anterior chamber is up here, the posterior chamber is up here. But your eye, many do not know that it's actually a pressure field, a pressure-filled sac. Everybody knows what blood pressure is. Blood pressure is 180 over or 120 over 80 mils of mercury. The pressure in a normal eye is around 10 to 15 mils of mercury. It's about an order of magnitude less than peak systolic pressure in your blood, in your bloodstream, systolic bloodstream. let's move on and get another one over here. So the sclera is going to be a major topic today, and in particular the regions in the back of the eye. We're also going to talk about a structure called the lamina crebrosa, and that's just a fancy anatomical term which means perforated layer. And the globe itself, as I mentioned, is primarily protected by the corneal scleral shell, except for a weak spot in the back of the eye that is the porous disc through which cells have to transmit signals. So the cells that are responsible for vision transmission are the retinal ganglion cells. And their cell body and nucleus exist in the retina, and their axons actually pass through this disc and go all the way to the brain. So these are very long cells. But interestingly, the back part of the eye is the weak point. If you look at this from a mechanical point of view, you basically have a scleral shell that's under pressure, and then you're trying to pass something that is very soft as compared to sclera, but very important, through a weak spot. That weak spot, if you were to look in from the anterior view, looks like this. It is primarily composed of type 1 collagen and elastin. The pores that you see, the large pores in the middle here, are for the central retinal artery and central retinal vein, which of course deliver oxygen and nutrient to vascular structures in the back of the eye. All of the peripheral pores that you see are the pores through which the axons pass. So this is a very, very important structure in terms of keeping the mechanical environment around the axons healthy in the context of healthy vision, in particular with respect to glaucoma. So when I talk to most people about glaucoma, I ask them, you know, have you heard of it? Most people say yes. It is a vision loss disease. It's the second leading cause of blindness in the world. Most people, some people get confused between cataracts and glaucoma. Cataracts are cloudiness in the lens, and then you can use a lens replacement to treat that. But glaucoma, many people think that glaucoma is equivalent to high intraocular pressures. And in reality, that's a misnomer. Glaucoma is not equivalent to high intraocular pressures. High intraocular pressure is called ocular hypertension. Glaucoma is loss of vision, and in particular, the loss of vision in glaucoma is due to the death of the transmitters, the death of the retinal ganglion cells in the back of the eye. And the reason that many people get confused about that is because there's a very high incidence of glaucoma in patients without ocular hypertension. However, you can have glaucoma at normal pressures. That's called normotensive glaucoma. So there's something else going on here than just high intraocular pressure killing the cells in the back of the eye. One of the reasons that pressure can increase in the eye is because if you look at the front of the eye, there's something called the ciliary body that basically produces aqueous humor that provides the oxygen and nutrients to the anterior structures of the eye. Of course, it's not blood, because if it was blood, light wouldn't be able to enter your eye and be focused on the back of your eye on the retina. What happens in glaucoma, in ocular hypertension, is this pumps out about 2.5 microliters per minute, but that's the faucet, the sink gets closed. Gets plugged or gets damaged. So you have a buildup of pressure. But as I mentioned, that doesn't happen in every single person that has glaucoma. So there's definitely something that is going on that is not just intraocular pressure. Myself and a few other labs across the states, United States, actually came up with a hypothesis that it's not just the pressure, but it's also the material properties. So I'll give you a little a demonstration here, if I can, with a little bit of hand waving. Picture a balloon. Spherical balloon. There's two ways to stretch that balloon. One is for me to blow it up with increasing pressure. That's probably the first thing you would think to do. Another way that I could increase mechanical deformation on a sphere at normal pressure is to change the material properties of that balloon. If I had a magic paste that increased compliance of that balloon and I put it on there, at the same pressure you would have a little bleb and an increase in strain. Very, very non-physiologic explanation of what we believe might be happening in the context of not just pressure, but pressure and mechanical properties. In particular, the mechanical properties of the peripapillary sclera, which is back here, and then this porous disc that I showed you a beautiful image of. Okay, so that sets the ground for. About 7 years ago, I was reading a paper by Harry Quigley, many papers by Harry Quigley at Johns Hopkins, And his group, who's a well-known expert in glaucoma, demonstrated via large population studies that there is a prevalence of primary open-angle glaucoma in patients with of Hispanic ethnicity and of African descent, especially, of course, at later decades in life. So this fact, along with the fact that there might be material properties involved in glaucoma, led to several hypotheses. I'm not going to cover the statistics here, you can read them, but this is the main goal of what we're trying to investigate. So the grant that funded this work for the past 5 years was aimed at doing testing these three hypotheses. And I won't go through all of them in detail, I'll just summarize by saying we're interested to see if the mechanical properties and the microstructure and how the structures in the back of the human eye are different in those at higher risk for glaucoma. So of Hispanic ethnicity and African descent versus those of European descent. Actually, the grant included glaucoma versus non-glaucoma, but the reviewers didn't like that because it's very hard to get glaucoma as tissue, although we have been successful in the past 5 years of doing that. That's the next grant. So, a little bit more about the back of the eye. There's been a lot of work and actually knowledge known about the ONH. This is the optic nerve bed. This is basically that disc that I showed you as porous. Around that disc, there are collagen fibers, a very, very dense, highly aligned collagen network that protects that canal. So think about it as a fiber-reinforced composite. You basically have a balloon, but you're stripping it with wire to keep it from inflating. And that's true of all humans. The other thing that's true, I like this illustration, this is Ian Segal actually at Pitt, showed that if this is that porous disc and this is the sclera, so this is the sclera and the lamina tuberosa, if you have a compliant sclera, then this deformation might occur. If you have a stiff sclera, then this, of course, you have to imagine both of these revolved about this axis of symmetry. Then if you have a stiff sclera, you actually increase the bending strains on the lamina tuberosa. So what we know at this stage, 5 years ago, is that it might be important. But we don't know how important, we don't know if it's the chicken or the egg, we don't know if it's a causation or just an association, we don't really know much. At this point, I had when I came to Arizona, I built a device called the Small Angle Light Scattering Device. And in summary, this device is used to map the orientation of collagen. So I'll give you a simple example. Pretend you have a heart valve that is 70 to 100 microns thick. You take that heart valve and you clear it optically using graded glycerol solution overnight and place it in between a light source, which is helium neon, about 630 nanometer wavelength light. That laser light is, of course, collimated but scattered, and that scatter is preferentially scattered in a direction that is corresponding to the local orientation of the collagen. So that scattering is captured on a plate and then, of course, recorded with a CCD. Of course, that's one point, and this is a 250 micron diameter light source. In order to raster scan this sample, we of course need an XZ translation system to basically move the sample through the laser beam. That's what it looks like in camera. This is what it looks like in reality. Actually, it looks a little different now. You'll see that towards the end of today's talk. Here's the Heaney source. Here's your sample. Here's your motion control. Here's your plate for capturing. Here's your CCD camera. So the first hypothesis we had that was funded by American Health Assistance Foundation was just in those of Hispanic versus Caucasian backgrounds, is there any difference in the back of the eye in terms of the orientation of collagen in the sclera? This is the kind of data you get. So this would be a sample that is randomly distributed. So you have an incoming circular light source that's scattered in a non-preferential manner, leading to a circular pattern of light splay on that glass screen. If you have fibers aligned according to or in the direction of this blue line, then you have preferential scatter orthogonal to those fibers. Of course, when you raster scan, you get something that looks like those magic ideals that were popular, I don't know how long ago. But if you stare at this long enough, you can see there's actually gradual transitions of collagen through that sample. This is what it looks like when you quantify it. So the cool part is this. Okay, so I'm going to define these just to get everybody on the same page. we're looking at the back of the human eye here. This is the optic nerve head. This is the sclera. Equatorial means around this direction. As I mentioned, we already knew that there was a preferential alignment around that direction. Meridional is just the orthogonal direction. So what we found was a statistical difference and a reduction in the amount of collagen in age-matched donors of African descent as compared to those of European descent. This was a paper we published that really allowed us to be successful in writing a large NIH grant to further investigate microstructure and mechanical properties of the tissues in the back of eyes from donors of these various at-risk populations. As I mentioned, the grant reviewers didn't like the fact that I had proposed glaucoma versus non. I still did it anyways. We published a paper looking at glaucomatous, which is G, versus normal. These are confirmed by a glaucoma specialist in Alabama, a collaborator of mine, using various non-repeatable metrics. We'll come back to that later. And what we found is if you combine all the races, you see across the depth, so the depth here is moving outside the eye towards inside the eye, you see a gradual transition in the equatorial alignment. This is a metric for equatorial alignment, being more equatorially aligned as you approach inside of the eye, and larger splay also as you increase towards the middle of the eye. Perhaps more interestingly, we just wanted to know if there was a difference in glaucomatous versus non-glaucomatous patients. And this demonstrated that there were differences. So the red here is glaucomatous, the blue here is non-glaucomatous. It didn't turn out exactly the way that we had hypothesized, similar to the African data that I showed you before. Right now, we're running computational simulations to try to understand what this means in terms of the deformations of that critical structure called the lambda cubosa in the back of the eye. When you write a grant for material property characterization, you have a laundry list of choices for devices to test things mechanically. You can do uniaxial tension. You can do uniaxial compression. You can do biaxial tension. You can do tension. You can do shear. You can do torsion. You can do AFN. You can do just about anything. As it turns out, there are a lot of people that came before me that did a lot of those different things. But the field has developed to the point where pressure inflation has become the gold standard for testing human ocular tissue, especially at the large scales. So we built a device we called the OcuGimbal, and I'll tell you why that's called that in a moment, where we placed markers through a window, and you'll see this thing rotate and tilt. But I show this picture because this is what it looked like before I had the large grant. If any of you have mechanical inclinations, the type of resolution and displacement you're going to get from this picture are not going to be helpful. They're not really going to really give you what you want. So when we did get funding, we had a little bit more fun. So I had a master's student that built this system. We called it the sequential digital image correlation system. There are a lot of different techniques you can choose within pressure inflation in terms of mapping deformation in tissues, especially for the eye. You can use digital image correlation, which is what this is, a version of this, in which you speckle pattern the surface and you use cameras to watch that speckle deform. There is electron speckle pattern interferometry, which uses lasers. It has very high resolution, but you use things at high displacements. There's ultrasound, there's MRI, there's a lot of different choices. We're going to talk about digital image correlation. And if you're not familiar, digital image correlation, picture just a flat sheet, you spray paint black dots onto it, you use one camera, you deform the sheet in plane, and you capture a high-res movie as that thing is deforming in plane. For one camera in 2D, it works perfectly. It works very, very well. The issue is when you have a curved surface, which is of course what we have when we have the back of a human eye. You and I have two eyes because we need depth perception. If we were all Univision, we would not have any depth perception. I think everybody pretty much understands that. The issue with having two cameras, which is what's indicated here in red, is, and that's the standard 3D digital image correlation, is you have to choose the stereo angle between the two cameras. As the stereo angle, the two cameras get smaller and smaller, you approach one camera. That's the situation in which you have the best XY resolution, which I mentioned. Of course, you're trading off good depth resolution when you do that. So you want a larger angle. The problem is this, as you increase the angle, you're less and less likely to be able to correlate this image with this image. And so there's a trade-off between small angle high XY, low Z resolution, large angle, good Z resolution, improper correlation. So what we did instead was we built a device that basically inflates the back of a human eye, uses one high-res movie, and then at a given pressure, rotates that eye in two orthogonal angles of parallax. The result of doing that, of course, is basically having an infinite, not infinite, but whatever time resolution you have for acquisition for your high-res camera, of virtual cameras anywhere in the choices of what you see here. So when you collect data that looks like this, you get images that look like this that come from movies that are like this. The interesting part of this cone here is you need that in order to register where you're at in space at each orientation. The disadvantage of this, and everything has its advantages and disadvantages, the disadvantage is we can't do viscoelastic testing. You have to get the sample happy and sitting there at a pressure, and then of course as you rotate it, you can't have pressure and deformation fluctuations. But we have done that. It's been pretty cool. This is what our system looks like when we high precision machined a sample, speckle patterned it, and did our sequential technique. If you did this same technique using the best optimum of one camera in our system, you get this result, which in XY looks pretty good. Here's the top surface of that nub, here's the second surface of that nub, and here's the bottom plate. So you have no Z resolution in the reconstruction in this particular situation. Why is this important? This is important because optic nerves, when you cut them, eyes, when you cut them out, have little optic nerve stumps. Okay, and all the data before this paper was published was quantifying deformation all around here. We were the first to be able to quantify deformation, including the optic nerve stump, including regions as you approach the very, very critical lamina cuberosa, which is hiding underneath that nerve stump. So we're now working on putting that data together. It's not necessarily as easy. This is just meant to show you what an eye might look like. Here's the fovea. You can see there's a spike. You'll see some displacement spikes. But even if you stare at the speckle out here, you can see things getting bigger and smaller. And that's what you see bone up here five times between pressure one and pressure two. Of course, the result of this is displacements. We can get a map of displacements for the nub and the sclera. Here we've taken the nub out. But here you can see we've added the nub back in. And of course, if we have displacements, we can calculate the gradients and use them to calculate strains. So it's a pretty cool little system. We're still using, we have, I think, 20 different data sets from each of the races, and we're still pumping the data through. I don't have data to show you on differences in that. But it's an exciting little situation. So that's great. Map strains. I can say the strains are different in the different races, but the hypothesis of the grant was material properties. And strains, large strains and small strains, can be due to differences in geometry as well as differences in material properties. In order to get material properties, we use what's called an inverse finite element technique. So any of you that have computational interest, this will be very, very interesting to you. A forward finite element analysis needs three things: loads, boundary conditions, geometry, and then the thing we're after, material properties. We don't know that, so I can't simulate these experiments. The result is displacement strains and stresses. Of course, this is the output of our experimental test. So the approach that you take is you do know the geometry, you do know the loads and boundary conditions because you're controlling them in the experiment, and you start with an initial guess of material parameters. That generates one forward finite element solution that generates a displacement field. That displacement field is then compared to the experiment, and of course, if you happen to be very, 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 very lucky, you're done, which never happens. You're going to have some error. That's going to require some updates, and you basically cycle through this until you have zero error, or next to zero acceptable error. Of course, this is not done by hand. This is done in MATLAB talking to your commercial finite element software, which is Abacus for us. Okay. So, interesting. The next problem is this. We have a whole globe, and there's already plenty of data in the literature showing that the properties are different at different places in the globe, meaning it's heterogeneous. So I can't, when I assign material properties right here, either for forward or for initial at each iteration, I can't just say the stiffness of the sclera is X, because it's going to be different everywhere in the globe. So you're going to have mass error if you make that assumption and you try to fit the data. So what we did instead was to use a subdomain technique. In a subdomain technique, we break the eye up into pieces. We take each individual piece, and this was one of those pieces. And on the inside of those pieces, on the internal elements of that subdomain, we load it with the pressure. On the outside, we need to do something. We can't fix it because that's not realistic with the experiment. Instead, we impose on it the displacements from the experiment. And then the cost function, or the thing we're trying to minimize, is the root sum squares of the errors of these nodes and their displacements with the experiment. And we do this for one subdomain, then we go to the next subdomain, then we go to the next subdomain until all subdomains are done, then we put the whole puzzle together and do it for the overall globe. And if things work well, then you have small area, you have an estimate for the material properties of that eye. We first started with a pie-cutting subdomain generation. We really didn't like this very much because this was taking too long. It would take 2 weeks to get one result, and we just don't have that kind of time. So what we did instead was use information about the displacement field to generate our subdomains. But before I get to that, we've tried this subdomain inverse technique with all different types of material property model types, and I'm not going to go into these details, but this is the simplest, this is the most complicated on the slide, as you can probably guess. In this one, we are actually utilizing information about fiber direction in the sclera. That comes through this term right here, in particular, offshore. So again, if we assume the whole globe to have one property, then its distribution of material parameters is flat. If we, for example, say that the region near the optic nerve head is less stiff than those around it, we could say that it's Gaussian. These are all just toy models to test our technique. We also used a random generated sum of Gaussians across the domain for the properties within that globe that we were seeking to identify. And I'll skip to the results, and I'll go real fast. The error was very acceptable in all four constitutive models and across all the subdomains. Same thing was the case for the very more complicated distribution. It's still fake though, since fake geometry, a fake distribution. I'm gonna skip this one. This is just for a different way of cutting up the pie. This is meant to indicate how we now currently divide our subdomain. So we take the displacement field, which is this guy, and we do a contour map, and then we project that contour map to divide up our subdomain. The reason we do this is because we're in this situation, we're assuming that the gray area here is a subdomain that has basically similar displacements. And so that's a zone that might be a material property set 1 for subdomain 1. And then of course each of these subdomains is solved, and then we put them all together and solve it again at the very end. When we do that for each subdomain, you can see we have less than 0.25 micron of displacement error, which means we have a very good estimate for properties. When you look at the overall solution, the global check, we also have less than 5 microns. The resolution of the SDI, the sequential digital image correlation, is 8 microns. So we are below the resolution limit of our experimental test, which is desired. I don't really have much to say other than this is the result. So point across here is the material property. This is the matrix stiffness. So if you have a soft tissue composed of a matrix and a fiber, this is the stiffness of the matrix. K1 is the modulus of the fiber that's in that constitutive model. K2 is the rate at which the collagen fiber uncrimps. Kappa is the degree of splay at a material point in the constitutive model. So this would be our fibers either aligned or not. And then fiber orientation is what you expect. It's the orientation of the fiber at any particular point. So we have a data, we have a material model and a parameter set that we can get from each of these eyes. As I mentioned before, the SDIC data is still being processed. We have this tool. Our next step is to take those tools and use them to get the properties for each race, and then tie it up in a nice bow, and then ask for more money. We will do that in the next year.
Quick question.
Yeah, sure.
So this model, do you expect this model to be essentially the same from one patient to another, or from within a patient from the left eye to the right eye?
So, I don't know if you all heard that. Do I expect the model to be the same from the left eye to right eye within one patient or within one eye of a patient? Depends on what you mean. If you mean the actual form of the energy, then you have to make that assumption because you have one stiffness matrix in your finite element model. And I am not aware that you'd have to go around with finite element code, which you have two numbers, not three. That's a limitation you have to live with. What model is best? That I can't speak to. This is able to fit the data. And even the parameters in this model, you might guess, are not unique, right? But it is a way for me to compare properties across races with those assumptions. But is it the best? Let me tell you, you're in my field. You know, people are just throwing things at me now because I chose that energy. I developed it, somebody smarter than me did in Germany named Gerhard Wolfhoff. That's the sclera. We're going to stop with the sclera. We're going to focus on this cool disc through which the axons pass. Let's do that. How do we test that? Okay. The structure is about 1.5 millimeters in diameter. There's no way I can speckle pattern this tiny structure and try to use SDIC to measure its deformation. So we are then now dealing with some sort of imaging technique at high resolution and magnification. Two-photon imaging is something we've been doing a lot of since 2007. You'll see a lot of that data in looking at this particular structure. So one idea, and this is where the OcuGobo comes in, so this was a pretty cool little device. What we want is to be able to image this structure, and we started 7 years ago imaging it from the posterior view. So we, of course, the human donor bank would cut the nerve, nucleate the eye from the donor, provide it to us, we cut it in half, anterior to posterior, inflate it, and we can watch what's happening with the structure. So we can rotate it if we wanted to, if we had a device to do this, rotate it. I had at that particular time a student that spent some time at a conglomerate building gimbal-based motion control devices to follow the stars. This is very obvious needed piece for devices like this. He spent about a year working with the senior design team building this device, that other movie. Which allows us at any given pressure to rotate both around the axis of the anterior posterior axis of the eye as well as meridionally at any given pressure. We thought this was pretty cool. In reality, we don't use this anymore, and I'll tell you why in a second. Actually, I'll tell you right now. This is the reason why. When you look at this structure from the back, this is what you see. When we looked at this, we said, we have a lamina cavrosa, it's there. And then, very, very disappointingly, after we spent this effort, colleagues of mine convinced me, if I try to publish this, don't try to publish this. So, the reason was because we're cutting through the structure that might be of interest. So we might be cutting it off, we might be inside of it, or we might be looking at structures posterior to the lamina cavrosa, so we don't know what we're looking at. So instead, we developed a technique to view anteriorly. You can see this is what, in optical coherence tomography, an actual clinician might see, except there's going to be a lot of blood vessels and retina in front of it, hiding it, and cleaning that stuff off, so that we can see beautiful images. This is a second harmonic signal of the human lamina cavrosa viewing anteriorly in one field of view. At this point, I also have to state that two-photon imaging, the power of two-photon imaging is that you do not have to fix or freeze your sample. Unlike any other, well, most other microscopy techniques, even if it's autofluorescent, you still have to fix, stain, section, and prep, and put your sample under your microscope. Because of the way two-photon and nonlinear optical microscopy works, you can get SHG, or second harmonic signal, which corresponds to fibrillar collagen, and two-photon excited fluorescence, which in this case is mostly elastin. This is a mouse aorta, so this is not an eye. But my lab has built probably about seven different devices, mechanical devices, to put underneath these fancy microscopes. The reason is because I can get images like this, and like that lamina cavrosa you just saw, at different pressures. I can inflate an image, inflate more, image, and from that, of course, I can try to get displacement of the image. In fact, you'll see some. So again, this is like a pressure inflation test using an optical microscope. So it's a pretty cool little way to do things. This is the data that you get. So again, we're using a fluorox objective. This is the eye being placed. The structure of interest is in the center. We use pressure inflation, and we get, if you look close enough, you can see red, green, turquoise, and blue. All of those represent this eye at different pressures. So this kind of data basically is how we're going to be investigating differences in race, and that's what we started to do. In fact, today you'll see some data that's new this week. What does a two-photon image look like of a human lemur to post? That's what this is. We're moving in depth, anterior to posterior. This is an optical sectioning technique allowing to get each section about 100 to 150, maybe even 200 microns deep into the tissue. So it actually can go very deep because of the longer wavelengths we're imaging at. Of course, we can get that image at different pressures. And if you look closely enough at this montaging movie, you can see a transition from one pressure to the next. So you can see it's moving from one pressure to the next pressure to the next. We tested four different pressures, 5, 15, 30, and 45. From this data, we can get displacements. Here's another cooler image looking at the different pressures. This, you can see the Z resolution is actually poor, but that's because it's 5 microns. The in-plane resolution is less than half a micron. It's actually more to do with the optics than so is the Z resolution, but the XY resolution is actually very good, as you can see from the anterior segment. If you look close enough, you can also see the cupping of the lemur tuberosum. That's common. Actually, that cupping is one of the clinical metrics for glaucoma. So now we're getting not just cupping, but change of cupping with pressure. So that's a pretty exciting way to look at things. If you just fit an ellipse to that disc, across, and I forget the numbers in this particular call, 3, 5, and 3, with those of Hispanic and African descent as compared to European descent, you can see that the areas are grossly different than the Hispanics, which is interesting in and of itself. The device that we have, of course, allows us to look at change in pressure of this area, and that's what this is. So the red here are those at lower risk of glaucoma, and you see at most things stay the same or perhaps even reduce in area. Both of those at higher risk of glaucoma actually increase in area. So this is direct evidence that the hypothesis that those of higher risk of glaucoma actually might be seeing larger deformations with fluctuations in pressure in the back of the eye. So when we saw this, we were very excited. We have a lot more data than 3, 5, and 3. In fact, this data is actual strain data. This is the eigenvalue of the green strain tensor. And again, what you see is the red and the blue, which are the at-risk groups. This is European descent, African, Hispanic. The green here looks much different than the other two. And we haven't done the statistics yet. I got this from my PhD student yesterday, so he hasn't done statistics yet, but that's going to happen soon. There are three invariants, so we look at all of them. We can also look at the orientations of those beams at any given pressure. So I'm going to slip through these pretty quickly, and I don't know how we're doing on time. Maybe 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, okay. So maybe I can go back then. So if we look at the strains, what I want you to look as I flip from slide 54 to the next two is the height of the green as compared to the heights of the red, blue, and red and blue. And what you'll see is, as I flip back and forth, 54, 55, the greens aren't changing much. The other two are changing. Same thing at higher or for the third invariant. The same thing happens if you look at the orientation of those beams of that porous structure. So this is at 5 mils of mercury. If we go up in pressure, you see these two at-risk patients actually changed. I'll go back again. This is 5 mils of mercury up in pressure. These two actually changed. This one didn't change. At higher pressure than that, everything changed. So again, we haven't quantified this other than the plots I'm showing you because I got it yesterday. But this is, yet again, more evidence that there is a difference. I think that's the most important thing I want to leave you with, is not all races and ethnicities are the same in terms of their microstructure and their load-dependent deformation microstructure in the back of the human eye, which is a really powerful statement, at least. least with the current state of knowledge in the field. One of the things that we purchased when the grant started was a very nice fluorescent microscope that has a montaging capability. So this is the montage actually zoomed out. If you zoom in, you can start to see all of these axons. So if you see these interlamellar beams here, those are the things that connect to the beams in the lamina pilosa. This is a section of the optic nerve behind the lamina pilosa, posterior to that structure, and you can see these axons. This is a myelin stain. The dark stain here is myelin for the sheaths of the axons of these retinal ganglia cells. Why do I show this to you? Well, remember I told you that the NIH didn't want me to study glaucoma because they didn't believe I could get repetitive information about what kind or what level of glaucoma people are at or not at. The reason that's the case is when I showed you that glaucomatous, non-glaucomatous table, there were all sorts of metrics provided to us by the donor eye bank from the treating ophthalmologist. You only get information from a treating ophthalmologist from an eye bank maybe 10% of the time. So even when you get that 10%, then you see different metrics. Well, how do you classify them? We classified them by me sending the clinical data to my clinical collaborator in Birmingham. And he graded them, and that's the best we could do. But still, it's not very repetitive, and you can't really say much about the degree of glaucoma. Axon counting is a very good metric for whether or not you have glaucoma or not. So we are working on MATLAB Go to count the 600 plus thousand axons in the back of each human eye. The reason is because we can identify for the pressure and structural information we've grabbed and quantified and worked very hard to get with numbers of axons. To confirm normality, first and foremost, but also to start to look at what do the numbers look like in glaucoma as compared to the deformation and the structures in the back of the eye. So again, even if I never get funded, I'll come back in 10 years and I'll fill you in on what that result was, because it's just going to take an enormous effort from here moving forward. Switching gears a little bit, I am a biomechanics person trained. That's the way I was trained. I'm starting, as Dr. Keller knows, to get into cell mechanobiology. One of the things that we started to do is, and this is in the literature, you can actually have the cells that are responsible for the remodeling of this lamina pilosa march off of this structure onto cell culture plates. And there are two primary cells that are responsible for what's going on in the lamina pilosa as far as matrix, the lamina pilosa cells and the astrocytes. And the only difference is one is GFAP positive and one is not. And so we've worked to show GFAP positive cells on various different coatings, and this is just an initial slide. I think more interesting, perhaps, is where I want to go with this. Let's say that I'm successful, and we have been successful in isolating those two cell types. What I'd love to be able to do is take two photon images of a decellularized and then recellularized lamina pilosa. So in order to get the two photon images that we saw, we actually have to mechanically treat the eye, and then biochemically treat the eye. And we've changed now that biochemical treatment to be a decellularization treatment. When we do that, we get, and here's the code here, the SHG here is just collagen. The green is collagen. So you can see some yellow and some red and yellow here, and green and the orange, showing that if you just took a human eye and took off the choroid and the retina and imaged it after staining for F-actin and DAPI, sonuclei, this is the data you get. If you decellularize, this is the image that you get. So this was very promising. The next thing we wanted to do is, can we reseed? Can we take a cell type of interest and reseed? And indeed we can. So we want this picture to look like that. This picture, these are all three different human beings. So not the same eye. But we can start to see some red and a little bit of yellow as well, which is promising in terms of studying how these cells react to pressure in our system as we move forward. We're building a bioreactor to do that. That's probably the next grant. I have a chemist friend, so we've talked about collagen, we've talked about elastin, and we've talked about remodeling of collagen and elastin. There are many different molecules responsible for changes in elastin and collagen as it's being turned over in the human body. One of the main players are proteases, and in that family, the matrix metal proteases are at or near the top of interest. I had an idea when I read a paper from a gentleman actually at Vanderbilt who was studying MMP7, which is vancomycin in cancer.
And he builds structures that look like this. So this is a dendritic structure. These are all fourth generation Ganem dendrimers. And on them he places a fret pair. And I don't know who's familiar with fret, but Fourier resonance energy transfer occurs when you deliver energy to the fluorescein. If it's close enough to this tetramethylrhodamine, then actually you lose the signal from the fluorescein because its energy is donated to the TMR. What then you do is you attach via a very specific amino acid sequence, a polypeptide chain that is specifically cleavable by a protease. And then the change in fluorescein relative to the signal of TMR is a way of non-invasively measuring protease activity in your sample. What happened done is this in single photon. This had not been done in two photon. We have a paper in review now where we have done the two photon increase in this fret response. This was important because what I want to do is do everything under this two photon microscope to be able to have collagen, elastin, living, being exposed to increases in pressure, and then looking at what's happening to the collagen and elastin, and then also what the activity of the protease activity of those cells that we had just isolated and seeded on that structure. So a really exciting future direction. This is where we're going to be headed. And of course, these proteases, MMPs, matrix metalloproteases, are ubiquitous in soft tissue. If an aorta is of interest, or cancer is of interest, as already mentioned, these tools are all directly applicable to any soft tissue remodeling problem. And as Rob knows, I've spread my lab over many different problems, glaucoma and coronary disease, to nerve paralysis and the vocal cords. So we're also doing micro-CT. I'm going to stop. I've warned you long enough. Oh, I have to show you this because it's got a cool name. Small angle light scattering is automated, so I'm in Tucson, so it's a great name. All of my undergrads very much appreciate a device that actually takes a cartridge and automates this process. Before that, for that two-year grant where I had that African versus Caucasian data, I probably had about 15 different undergrads over a two-year period cranking on that. Now we can do it actually much more automated. It's kind of awesome. I have to thank the lab, and this is not the whole lab, but these folks up here, Sundaresh did a lot of the digital image correlation. Andrew started the CellWorks. He's my research engineer. Here's the Axon Lady Addison. These are my course. Some of these folks have gone now into bigger and better things. Of course, I have to thank the NIH for the funding, and I will now stop talking and let you ask questions. Thanks.
So we definitely have time for questions. We've got about 11 minutes remaining in the room, and thank you for leaving us some time for questions. So, yes, please.
So I'm interested in the connection between the structural differences that you saw see across races and the sort of how the biomechanics of the structure really leads to problem.
Yeah.
And it seemed like in your model, if you find an element of modeling work, that the fovea has the most deformation. You see where I'm going with this question. And of course it has also the largest largest density of retinal ganglion cells. And so it seems like I guess one question is whether in glaucoma it's the foveal retinal ganglion cells that are preferentially die. And then the second question is whether the biomechanics of the different eye structures is distributing that sort of the deformation as you change the pressure away from the fovea or protecting the fovea from more deformation as you increase
the pressure. So interestingly, in the back of the eye and the retina, what happens first? The first cells to die, the first retinal ganglion cells to die in early onset glaucoma, are actually peripheral. They're not in the fovea, which is kind of counterintuitive based on what we were just discussing. And then over time, of course, you start losing peripheral vision, and eventually in glaucoma you lose all of your vision. But it approaches from the outside. There's a good image on that. As far as the fovea itself, interestingly, that area actually has a thinner sclera.
which is why you see higher deformation. Now, we are taking the thing out of the human, pumping it in the lab, and watching what happens to it. And our motivation for doing that is to identify properties. We assume that its deformation that we're characterizing is very physiological. There's going to be some trade-off there in terms of how physiological that is. The best test, of course, is an in vivo test. But that would require gated MRI at high resolution, something that's not capable resolution-wise at this stage. But as far as protection of the fovea, I would say from a mechanical point of view, you know, 5 to 7 years ago, really mechanics wasn't even part of the story. People just thought pressure was high, cells are dying, stop, unplug the sink in the back, in the front of the eye. That's actually, if you get, my mom and my mother-in-law have ocular hypertension, they take drops. The function of that pharmaceutical is to unclog the drain in the front of the eye. But the cells that die are in the back of the eye. So if you look at glaucoma researchers, you can kind of almost divide them, front people and back, posterior people and anterior people. And from a mechanical point of view, that's not a good idea. So we're starting to ask questions about how the two are related. That is even more in its infancy. Folks at Alabama and Devers Eye Institute in Portland and Hopkins have people at those institutions like me that are mechanics people that are starting to ask those kinds of questions. At Devers Eye Institute, they have a monkey model for glaucoma. And the model for glaucoma is inject some beads and plug the sink. That's the model. And then you have ocular hypertension, then you have cell death. It's not a good model for normal testing glaucoma. It's, I would say, also not a model for testing these mechanical things because you're already decided that it's pressure you want to study. So adding to that, maybe changing properties of the soft tissue, maybe having knockouts of a particular protease or a particular protein that's mechanically important, might start to tweak some of those questions. But the whole field is really in its infancy with regards to that. But as far as the fovea itself, I don't know why that's protected in the really long. I don't know.
Do you think fibroblasts might be involved?
Fibroblasts?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, it depends on what structure you're talking about. I can guarantee you the major cell type in the sclera is fibroblasts. So sclerofibroblasts would be what would march off of the sclera if you got it from a pig, put it on a plate with culture media, sclerofibroblasts would then come off. The density of fibroblasts in the sclera is actually really small. So you wouldn't get a lot of cells. It's not very dense, excuse me. In the lamina cabrosa, there are very few fibroblasts. But the lamina cabrosa cells and the astrocytes play the role of the fibroblasts in that zone. So I'm not a fibroblast expert, but I know the two cell types of interest in terms of matrix remodeling in the lamina are those two cell types, and not the fibroblasts, which are of interest in the sclera. One of the areas of research is actually that involves sclerofibroblasts is myopia. So myopia is nearsightedness. In nearsightedness, your eye is actually too long in the anterior posterior direction. And the reason it's too long is because it gets thinner. The sclera in the posterior segment gets thinner, and the whole eye gets longer. So you wear it, it's corrected with, I'm hyperopic, not myopic, but you can correct it with spectacles. The cells that are in the sclera are the ones responsible for making that tissue thinner, for making your eye longer, and then basically in some instances causing retinal detachment, other bigger issues than just needing eyeglasses. But in terms of the sclera and its protection of the lamina, absolutely fibroblasts can be
triggered. Glaucoma, perhaps. I just think that perhaps maybe something to do with inflammation and self-proliferation and apoptosis.
So as far as the mechanisms of cell death for the retinal ganglion cells, I would leave that to somebody else to answer. But I know that it's still a debated topic.
Do you see potentially with your work you could collaborate with someone in 3, 4, or 5 years?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So as far as collaborators on this project, obviously it's clear that it's a very mechanical project at this stage. When I move into these cell mechanobiology studies, I'm going to need an expert. There is not a cell biology expert in that particular area at Arizona.
in terms of just neural cells and neuromechanobiology, or just neurobiology, absolutely. I'm looking for people that are excited about that, that have the skills that would build a team that would be effective in answering those questions. Because it won't be just me. My closest clinical collaborator for glaucoma is in Alabama. So I want to change that too.
This is more of your preparation of the eye. So you get from eye banks, from donor banks. And so usually what would you receive them with the cornea and maybe the mucosa banks?
Okay, yeah. So a pair of human eyes that are whole cost $2,000 a pair. If we don't know this. Ours cost $1,000 a pair. And what we get, the lens has been removed for transplant. Some cases the cornea, but most often the lens. We're interested in the back half of the eye for this project. So what happens to the front when we get it, we could care less, really. But for the past 5 years, we've collected, I think, probably 100 eyes, 50 pairs of each race over 5 years. And most of that data has been banked because I just don't have the personnel to crank through all the things I'd love to do with those, so we have to bank them. And we can't, see the hardest part is we can't control what we get going. I might get 3 in 1 week, I have to test one, freeze the other two. That happened a lot, we were spending a lot of money, eventually I had to cut it off in year 5. But it's not like a monkey where you can induce on day 1, follow it very closely, sacrifice. It's, oh, you have a Arizona, or donor network of Arizona has an eye, it's right now, gotta go get it, gotta test it. Can't freeze it if you're interested in mechanics, so you have to do something else with that later.
Do you think that you'll be worth looking into the, how the mechanical stiffness of the cells contribute to the overall stiffness of your sample?
I think absolutely yes. And I would say,
and also you mentioned about collagen, that like how these cells interact with the collagen.
Yeah, so the slide that I put up where we're D-cell and B-cellular, that's part of the motivation. I would say that sclera versus lamina, I would be interested more in the lamina from that point of view because of the low density of fibroblasts in the sclera. The lamina, as you saw, has a very high density of lamina, fibrosis, and astrocytes. And so how those cells are reacting to the collagen, that's absolutely what we need to do in the future. The best experiment I can run or envision right now is keeping things alive over a short-term ramp in the pressure, or maybe even TGF-beta or other biochemical cytokine stimulation or combination of that. You have to keep the thing alive quite a bit though to see measurable changes in collagen. So early on, you probably just want to study gene and protein expression as a function of these different things.
Have you been able to study any eyes of Asian descent?
Asian? Yeah. So, because of the cost of the eyes that we do get, we did receive one. We didn't do anything. I have one Asian eye, but I have, so in order to do this kind of research, you don't go to one eye bank and then work with that one eye bank. So there are 2 eye banks in Arizona that I work with. I work with the San Diego Eye Bank, I work with the Illinois Eye Bank, I work with the Michigan Eye Bank, I work with the Cleveland Eye Bank, and I work with the Alabama Eye Bank. And all of those, the reason I need to do that is because I need a Hispanic over 50, without glaucoma, the list goes on, I have selection criteria, and so I have to spread the net really wide, and then wait. Asian wasn't an option, so we just have to turn those away because of the cost. That's a good question. We have had requests for those.
You know what they would be closer to? Would they be more of
any ideas? I don't. I know from a myopia point of view, those would be very important eyes to look at because myopia is more prevalent in Asian countries than it is in European and Western civilization.
Okay, join me in thanking Dr. Van Gies for just a wonderful session.